from the top. Rhythm is present in every aspect of biological life. It's present in essential functions like breathing. It's present in everyday activities like walking and speaking. In fact, all of us are exposed to rhythm before we're even born in the form of our mother's heartbeat. So rhythm is present in every aspect of life, but how does it work in music? That's what we're going to take a look at today. So first, we're going to look at the psychologic perception of rhythm. Rhythm is defined as the serial pattern of variable note durations in a melody. This means where notes are placed in time in a song, as well as how long those notes are. Rhythm is based on tempo and meter, tempo being the pace of the music, commonly associated with the beats per minute, the BPM, and meter being the timing framework under which a given pattern of rhythmic durations is understood. This is associated with strong and weak beats, as well as the grouping of beats. For example, a waltz, the beats are grouped in series of three. So 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Rhythm is essential for musicians. Musicians can play on or around the tempo and rhythm. You can choose the duration of your notes. Staccato notes sound like they're bouncing. Drawn out notes have a slower character. You can play slightly before the beat for a rushed effect, or behind the beat for a swung effect. Master musicians control the placement and duration of their notes to maximize the aesthetic and emotional effect. When we hear rhythms, we hear meter as groups of stronger and weaker beats. And this is known as metric accenting. So if we look at this diagram here, this is a 4-4 time signature. We have four beats. Typically in a 4-4 time signature, the first beat, also known as the downbeat, is the strongest, followed by the third beat, the next strongest. The two and the four are typically weaker. When a drummer plays, they can play a typical drum progression that highlights the strong and weak beats, playing a bass or kick drum on the one, a snare on the three, and then a softer hi-hat on the two and the four. And that sounds a bit like this. Now, I'm going to give you guys a little demonstration to show you that metric accenting is something that exists in our brains. It's not just something that drummers choose to play. Listen to the sound of this clock ticking. Did you hear it as a single sound repeated over and over? Or did you hear it as a sequence of alternating strong and weak beats? In other words, did you hear it as tick, 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 tick? Or did you hear it as tick, tock, tick, tock? In fact, what I just played was a single sound repeated over and over. But some people perceive it as a sequence of alternating strong and weak beats. This is an audio illusion, known as subjective accenting. It shows us that meter is something that is hardwired into our brains. So let's look at the physical nature of rhythm. We just mentioned that rhythm involves where notes are placed in time and how long each of those notes are. The JND is the just noticeable difference for a given stimulus. So the just noticeable difference for the length of a note, the duration of a note, is 2.5% for notes between 240 and 1,000 milliseconds. But for notes that are below 240 milliseconds, that decreases to about 5 to 6 milliseconds consistently. Now, we talked about tempo being the overall pace of the music. You can tell when a tempo is off by about 4.5 to 8%, somewhere in that range. Now, tempo is universally associated with emotions. Faster tempos are associated with happiness and activity, and slower tempos are associated with sadness and reflection. Let's take a look at how rhythm is processed in our brains. Rhythm begins as the placement, duration, and periodicity of notes. The sound signal goes through the ear and the vestibulocochlear nerve and reaches the brainstem. In the brainstem are neural circuits called central pattern generators, CPGs, that drive rhythmic output without need for any sensory input or feedback. These are what power your internal metronome. Also processed in the brainstem are the duration of notes. In order to understand how rhythm is processed in our brains, we have to understand rhythmic entrainment. Music and rhythm involves loops or cycles. Rhythmic entrainment is how we synchronize our internal metronomes to the external cycles of music. It's how we lock into a beat or a rhythm. Rhythmic entrainment can be broken down into 5 stages. The first, neuronal entrainment, is when internal neuronal firings are driven by and fire in phase with the external signal. This is known as phase locking and is the foundation for all other levels of entrainment. The second, perceptual entrainment, involves the formation of our internal representations of rhythm and meter. We form a mental representation, a structure that gives us the ability to expect and anticipate future beats.
Try tapping along to this beat. Listen and train yourself and really lock into the rhythm. Tapping studies show us that participants consistently tap a few milliseconds before the beat. If they were only reacting to the beat, they'd be tapping a few milliseconds afterwards. This is how we know that we predict and anticipate future beats and don't just react to the beats that we hear.
Perceptual entrainment involves a large network of areas around the brain. It involves motor areas like the primary motor cortex and supplementary motor area. It involves the cerebellum, which helps coordinate movement, and the basal ganglia, which regulates movement. In fact, our ability to perceive and follow rhythm cannot be separated from our motor functions. Rhythm and motion are intrinsically tied together. The temporal anticipation aspect of rhythm is believed to involve Brodmann area 47, this area of the frontal lobe. The third level of entrainment, autonomic, is how our unconscious biological systems like heart rate and respirations synchronize or attempt to synchronize to the rate of the music. For example, when we hear fast-paced music, our heart rate increases. When we hear slower paced music, our heart rate decreases. This is a slower process than the other levels of entrainment. The fourth level, motor entrainment, involves conscious physical movement and depends on perceptual entrainment. This is quick. As soon as you perceive a clear beat, you can move along to it. This is the process of keeping rhythm while dancing, singing, or playing an instrument. The fifth, social, involves our ability to entrain to the cycles of other people. For musicians, this is how we synchronize with each other in a group or a band. In fact, non-musicians socially entrain to others every single day
in the form of conversation. Rhythmic entrainment is not only musical. It's a mental process that's present in walking, talking, and many other functions of daily life.
Next, let's talk about groove. Groove is the compulsion to move along to music combined with the positive feeling, the positive affect associated with the process of entrainment, the feeling that we get when we want to move along to music. And studies that have looked at groove have shown that it's more strongly associated with tempos around 100 to 130 BPM. And it's also associated with syncopation and expressive timing. Right now, we don't completely understand how groove works, but the working hypothesis is that syncopation and expressive timing optimizes that predictive engagement, optimizes that mental representation we have of music, and makes the listening a more active process rather than a passive process. Lastly, let's take a look at a rhythm deficiency. So Parkinson's is the degeneration of cell bodies in the substantia nigra, that's a part of the midbrain responsible for releasing dopamine. When the substantia nigra degenerates, there's decreased dopamine output, which impairs motor function. So how's that work? Here on the right, I have a diagram of two pathways through the basal ganglia that start up here at the motor cortex, go through the basal ganglia, and come back up to the motor cortex. So on the left, we have the direct pathway, which is stimulatory, causes motion. And on the right, we have the indirect pathway, which is inhibitory and stops motion. The role of dopamine in both the direct and indirect pathways is to regulate these processes. Without dopamine, we see inhibition of these pathways, which leads to some typical symptoms of Parkinson's disease, including the tremors, the rigidity, and akinesia, or inability to move. People with Parkinson's disease also have a lot of trouble with their internal metronomes, with their rhythm. And that makes sense because we mentioned the basal ganglia plays a very important role in rhythm. So there have actually been attempts to use rhythmic stimulus, external rhythmic stimulus, in order to help treat some of the symptoms of Parkinson's disease. Now, how does this work? Someone with Parkinson's can listen to a metronome ticking, maybe music playing, and attempt to entrain to that external stimulus and regain some of the functions of gait and rhythm. This recruits some external pathways in the brain. So it involves pathways that go around the areas that are damaged, leading to some improvement in symptoms. So as an overview, rhythm is the pattern of notes and beats in time, as well as their duration. And it's based on the structure of meter and tempo. We entrain to rhythmic stimulus on a number of levels: neuronal, nerves firing, perceptual, our mental representations, autonomic, breathing, heart rate, motor, which is dance, and social, which is entraining to the movements of others. Rhythmic entrainment allows for groove, which we don't fully understand yet, but there are a number of studies currently going on that are trying to understand why we like to move to music. And as a final note, rhythm is one of the basic building blocks of music and is absolutely necessary to create good music. The good news for most musicians out there is that rhythm is evolutionarily present in almost all humans. You might not think you have rhythm, but you do.